Throughout this series, some of you may have wondered, wow, that unison string melody sounds absolutely fantastic. Smooth and rich, perfect cinematic strings. You've got good ears, and will be pleased to know that this is, in fact, two brand new Big Bang Orchestra libraries, Lyra and Muska, which are low unison strings and high unison strings. Right after the trumpet melody in this cue, the strings take the melody. You know what the most awesome part of this library is? For this cue, I set just one articulation, the legato with strong vibrato, and that's all I needed. A little bit of mod wheel movement, but that's it. I love the synchron strings, which are used for the first half of this recording, but this beautiful recording of unison legato first and second violins and violas is just stunningly beautiful. The vibrato is excellent for the cinematic stuff, and it's fast. There's hardly any programming. In fact, with the exception of a couple of beginnings of the notes I bumped around a hair, this is the original performance I played in. Simple as that. Now, a note on the unison cello. The cello are up there in the tenor clef, and this is recorded unison with double basses, or the sample library is recorded unison with the double basses. It requires that I use the keyboard range extender here. And also that on these notes, I don't drop down an octave. The issue with dropping an octave is that the tone is changed, and you really hear the girth of the double basses in that part, so I just made it a repeated note, and you seriously can't tell the difference. I made a couple little note moves in the high strings. I bumped them up a little ahead of the low strings, just so the volume of the section didn't dip too much on the repeated note. Let's talk about what's happening in the accompaniment. We come off a part where we've had constant color swoops from the woodwinds, keys, and harps. We have this chord bass line accompaniment with a lot of doublings, but no French horns. Now, the French horns are in, right in the center of their register, playing some non-chord tones for color, and the basses are doing the syncopated pizzicato stuff. At the ends of the phrases, we get little rhythmic things coupled with runs in the woodwinds, only this time with piccolo. This is all about color change to match the melody that, for a march in the old American John Philip Sousa style, would kind of resemble like a trio section. Obvious choice number one to achieve this is to have trumpets sit out. Obvious choice number two is to pass the melody to strings, because we know that the next section will need to be even softer, which means the obvious choice is going to be giving the woodwinds the melody, probably to someone who cuts through the orchestra clearly, like an oboe, and that's what happens. Obviously, choice number three, there's no more percussion. Okay. John Williams makes all of these obvious choices, leaving him with these colors: strings, horns, trombones, woodwinds, keys, and harps. No trumpets. No percussion. There are three main criteria that need to be fulfilled in order for this to work musically, I guess you could say. The first is propel the rhythm. The second, fill in the gaps on the long notes during the melody. Like, if there's a long note in the melody, a quarter note or a half note or something like that, things need to be happening underneath it to keep the momentum going or whatever. And the last one is establish softer, less bright colors. Well, if tasked with fulfilling these criteria, the nature of each instrument plugs itself into its natural habitat. For example, propelling the rhythm, horns are on the upbeats, like, in American concert bands, especially for junior high and high school pieces or whatever, I feel like 80% of the time the French horns are playing this upbeat stuff. We also have the basses laying out until some syncopated pizzicato stuff, which incidentally helps fill in the other two criteria in softening the colors and filling in the gaps where the melody is on a long note or resting. on the second criteria, filling in these gaps, we can reintroduce trombones with a couple rhythmic figures and this weird tuba bass pizzicato counterpoint thing here. Then we have the flute runs at the end of the measures. The flute and clarinet runs have been reduced to just flutes. We have no double reeds playing. And all that together, making the colors softer and less bright. I suppose an argument can be made that the introduction of the piccolo does make things brighter in a sense. But in context, it doesn't, because we are no longer in a constant state of up and down, massive harp gliss, woodwind scale runs type things. Now, the scale runs are merely punctuated at the end of the measures in service to the second criteria, filling in the gaps on and long notes of the melody. We also have the absence of the celeste and down to one harp and only piano doing the constant runs. Note, it does fall over the same beats as when the trombones are also doing the punctuating. All that considered, the piccolo isn't adding brightness, but let's call it clarity and punctuation. All of these choices in total give a very distinct color and mood change that, because of the nature of the melodic writing, seamlessly blend from the first section to this one. It's incredibly smart writing and orchestration. I would highly recommend using these criteria yourself when orchestrating a melody. What is propelling the rhythm? How do you fill in the gaps? And what can you do to change the color from the previous section? In the fourth and final part of this series, we will cover orchestral mixing.